whenever you eventually get to what was it? Yeah, it was actually the name of a segment of wall in the Imperial Palace. It was the what are the Horus Heresy books now? I gotta look that up.
Was it the border wall?
Yeah, with the ice agents. Yeah.
Make Terra great again.
Yep. And we're gonna make we will make Horus pay for it.
Yes. Horus will pay for the wall.
Yes.
We're gonna build a wall. It's gonna be great. It's gonna be fantastic.
Saturnine. That was a Saturnine.
Oh, Saturnine.
Yeah.
The Saturnine wall. Okay. Yeah. I've heard about that. Don't know shit about it, but I've heard the name.
It will cost us billions and billions of Imperium dollars.
What the hell's the name of the currency? It's
Gelt. Just changes.
Thrones. That's what it was.
Which, by the way, is the exact same thing as Warhammer Fantasy.
Who says those two universes aren't connected?
Listen, they are in the same way.
I'm telling you, bro.
It's different. It is different. They're not connected.
It's different.
It is different.
Hey, that can be another shirt. We could have a little space wolf room too.
It's different. Yes. I think it might be a good idea. We're almost halfway to 500. Actually, at the moment,
yeah, we're six away from 250.
Are we?
Yeah, we're four away now.
Oh, we're at 246 now.
Since I woke up this morning, we've gained about 8 subs.
I know.
Yeah, so since I last checked it this morning, because I was listening to the Night Lords episode, since I last checked it, we had 239. So the fact that we're at 250.
Yeah, we were at like 240, and then we dropped down to 239 because some.
Well, it's probably us saying, let's toss all the in a concentration camp. We'll go from there.
I mean,
yeah.
Well, you bleeped out the word, so you know.
Yeah, there's still an anime girl in an SS uniform. Well, but
hey, it's an anime girl from an actual anime.
Listen, yeah, I'm not gonna lie. When I saw the anime chick, I immediately thought that was Lotara Sarin, and I was gonna fucking shit my ass. Like, I'm not even gonna lie to you. I was gonna shit a chicken
on her chest.
Yeah, I was gonna call you and be like, "Hey, what the fuck? You better take that shit the fuck down."
Sarin's great. Sarin stays over there.
Oh shit.
Let me pull out this 3-page long overview.
It was 3 pages long.
Yes, it's 3 pages long, and that's only because I don't write front and back.
So what do you guys want to talk about? We got a cold open.
I mean, hell, that was a pretty good cold open.
It was. We could use that. I'm just not sure if we want to. I mean, we could use it. Unless we want to. I don't know.
I mean, you can put a whole bunch of Nazi girls
in front of
Auschwitz.
Hey, we didn't get struck last time. We're going to do our best this time.
Because I started recording back when we were talking about Garrow going to a planet to go recruit a new Grey Knight and shit. And like the dude was like an assassin, but he was still like an old Luna wolf. And he was actually, he was going to assassinate a traitor. That's what it was.
Hmm.
That's what I meant to say. And then I guess the house fucking blew up. And then here comes Garrow in a Deus Ex helicopter. Okay, like came down, swooped him up. It's like, no, you're coming with me. And
get
then
to
they
the
go,
chopper.
Yeah, yeah. And there goes the other trial of Grey Knight recruiting.
Get to the Adeptus Mechanicus Ornithopter. Do it now.
You are now listening to Heresy FM. Ain't your commissar station.
Welcome to the podcast. This is Korn alongside Groot and Stepabru. We are talking about, who are we talking about today?
We're talking about the Blurred Angels.
Talk about the Ninth Legion.
The story of Space Jesus.
He's Space Jesus in more ways than one. And we'll get into that.
If Space Jesus was blonde. And
Aryan Space Jesus.
Aryan Space Jesus.
Yes.
Bring out the girl Zoom Panzer Nazi.
Why does anybody keep talking about the Jews? I don't get it. Little-known fact, Sanguinius fought at the Battle of Stalingrad.
Sanguinius is over there throwing up Romans and shit.
Sanguinius
with the tiki torch.
Why do the people on the moon of Baal Secundus keep calling themselves Sanguinius' chosen people?
They didn't go to Argentina, they went to Baal. It all makes sense now. Oh, goddamn. Okay, so Blood Angels.
Outstanding.
Blood Angels.
This sounds very menacing if you don't know 40K, but when you know Blood Angels, it's like they're still menacing, but
they are
in a nice way.
Well, yeah. They're great until you piss them off.
I mean, true,
then,
true.
Then or you're fighting you the world eaters.
Suspiciously looking like Horus.
Well, there goes my Halloween costume, but.
So, the Blood Angels. Well, starting off, they didn't start off as the Blood Angels. They started off as the Revenant Legion.
Ooh.
Spoopy. Edgy.
Yeah, they were well known for their bloodthirsty keck nature in battle. However, very feared because they had a cursed gene seed known as the Red Thirst, which we'll get into that a little. We can get into that a little bit later.
Yeah. So how shall we begin? Right.
Where do you begin with this? There's so many spots you can begin.
I'm going to try and then steer it however you want. I'm just going to start listing off random shit. Long before something, something, Emperor Jizz Juice, 26, 28 miles an hour.
Go back to episode one.
Yeah, go back to episode one. Yeah.
So should we just start with Sanguinius and then
fuck it, we'll go
until,
to
until he, like, start with Sanguinius and then merge him into taking over the Legion and shit?
That's probably the best thing. All you really need to know about the early Revenant Legion was, I mean, basically they serve, whereas the other Legions served as, you know, a real army, you know, tactical and all that, the Blood Angels were an absolute inferno upon the battlefield. They didn't conquer, but instead ravaged everything.
Almost like world eaters, but before Angron, and then after the Primarchs came into this way, they kind of like
swap spots almost. Oh shit!
Okay. So Sanguinius landed on Baals Secundus, and during this time, this was a very interesting place to be, right? Because Baals Secundus was a radioactive wasteland shithole of nobody wants to fucking be here.
Welcome
full of mutants.
Fallout Ball edition.
Yeah, Fallout Ball.
Yeah. Hey guys, I have a tertiary ball. Is that normal?
I mean, if you lose one, you're good. So
okay.
Hey, it's always good to have a spare tire.
Let's see, that's Primaris, Secundus.
Yep. But that being said, he has the unique distinction of having a unique characteristic the other Primaris don't have, which are the giant fucking wings on the back. How he got them, we don't fucking know. The official story is radiation. But if Follow saw me anything, radiation does not give you wings. It just
Red Bull
fucks you up.
A lot of Red Bull.
Oh, Red Bull. That
actually,
was it.
That's what
it
is. Actually, they have made a really cool mechanic in the new Fallout games, 76.
Yeah.
Fucking radiation actually gives you mutations now.
Really?
Yes. Wow. It's actually pretty cool.
You know, I thought about picking up 76. That does seem pretty good.
It's not so. It's not terrible nowadays.
From what we hear, it's not the dumpster fire it was when it first came out.
Oh god.
You guys ever seen the Internet Historian video on Fallout 76?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Yeah.
Wait, say again?
Do you know who Internet Historian is?
No.
Okay, after this. Okay, we're going to pull some videos
Is it like Fallout lore and shit like that?
He generally documents a whole bunch of Internet history, right?
Oh, interesting.
Yeah, okay. So like 76 happened, a whole bunch of other stuff. We'll explain more after this.
It started out as a dumpster fire. It's not so bad now. But yeah, you get fucking like mutations and shit. Like I was walking through and I ended up getting like high mutation and I got like a marsupial pocket. I think I lost like 2 intelligence, but I gained like a plus 20 on my carrying capacity. I was like, fuck yes. Baals Secundus was an absolute fucking shitstorm of a fucking radioactive just desert. It really was Fallout. It was Fallout, Mad Max, full of raiders just in the desert, just pillaging and doing whatever they fucking wanted.
Yeah. Now, humanity still clung to Baals Secundus in like very, very small pockets, right? With individual tribes, everything else, still rampant mutation. But the vast wasteland that covered the majority of Baal is sort of where Sanguinius landed. And that's a place that nobody can really survive for any extended amount of time.
Nobody except for a Primarch.
So next thing you know, these tribes are doing their own little tribe shit. I don't know, probably eating people or something. And the next thing you know, is out of this desert that nobody can live through is basically like any of those old Catholic statues with like the giant angels that are like majestic with the wings coming out. Butt naked out of the radioactive wasteland is Sanguinius, right?
Yeah, when he emerged, I was doing because very little's known of how long he traveled the desert of Baals Secundus. He doesn't really talk about it. He doesn't mention his early days a whole lot. But by the time he was found, he was already, like, he was found as a young boy, but he was almost of age.
Yeah.
So almost like a 12, 13-year-old boy.
Yeah, so granted, Primarchs grow up pretty fast, right? They age fast. But at the same time, it still takes, like, a couple, few years to actually, like, develop into an adult for a Primarch, right? Yeah. It's not, we're not talking days or weeks. We are talking, like, a couple years, right?
And they saw him and almost killed him for the wings. They were like, fuck you.
Apparently, at 3 weeks, he was a large child capable of walking. And in like a year, he was taller than any fucking man on Baals of Gundus, which I didn't know Baals of Gundus was a moon of Baal. Mm-hmm. I thought, nah, no shit.
Yeah, he landed on a moon.
Yeah, that's crazy. And there were people leaving on that fucking moon. It's like, well, if Baals of Gundus fucking sucks, what does the actual planet of Baal look like?
That's a good question. I don't know that off the top of my head. I'm not sure.
Yeah, I'm not sure what Baal actually looks like. I know that it hashtag
makes. I can say what my balls look like.
I was waiting. This whole episode is just one giant dick joke.
Hairy and a slight wrinkle or two, but. But yeah, so I guess obviously he was spared. Don't know much about that, but he was a prodigy. By his adoptive parents, he quickly learned everything he could, gained a lot of accolades in his time on Baals of Gundus. He slew a giant fire scorpion with his bare hands, slew a band of feral mutants, and eventually became basically a living god to his people. He became known as basically an avenging angel.
Okay,
now we're in ASMR mode.
There you go. We'll do it.
Pretend it's a vagina and just, you know. There it is. Yeah.
But he eventually became a literal god to his people, like basically an avenging angel that eventually people, he almost became like the Mecca that people came to just kind of worship. But he took that role very reluctantly, which is kind of a reoccurring theme. He doesn't like being put in a seat of power.
That's fair.
Or being in the spotlight. I've noticed. He kind of just wants to be his own thing. He understands his purpose, but
that's very 100% true on that. Now, whatever it comes to Sanguinius, part of the reason that makes him so special is because he sort of embodies, like, not sort of the actual, like, sheer love for humanity like Vulcan has, but he is the aspiration of what humanity is supposed to. Okay, now it's my turn. He embodies
sexual. Not gonna lie.
As we're going around, it's
this episode really is gonna be this episode really is gonna be nothing but dick and fellow job jokes.
Subscribe to our Patreon for more. But
for behind the scenes,
my settings now. Shit. So. He's the embodiment, right? We always have something we want to aspire to look up to. Right. And whenever you're an irradiated mutant, probably on Baal with three Baals, then in that case, this creature very quickly understands he's reluctant with the position, but at the same time, he knows and fulfills the duties that are given to him, right? So they didn't nominate him as sort of like a god, but also he's the standard that they aspire to because they're, again, irradiated wastelanders. Basically going through life, barely living, probably, you know, suffering the entire fucking time. Here comes a literal angelic being, you know, being coming down. Like we always talk about, well, why do the emperor, obviously, if you show up like a god, they're going to treat you like a god. Sanguinius got the same treatment, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
And also interesting thing, you know, the entire time, because we talked about this with Kurz and everything. Sanguinius also had a foresight. Except he wasn't, yes, he you know, absolutely batshit crazy, so he didn't see all the negative. The opposite side of the coin is Sanguinius understood, I guess, for lack of better words, understood that there was a choice.
Yeah.
And therefore, he saw where the choices would lead and went, I guess, chose the best course of action from those choices.
Yeah, so whenever he saw it, it was sort of like you were saying, like when Kerr saw all the bad stuff and he very much like understood, hey, bad stuff's going to happen. He saw the worst of it. Sanguinius would always see the positives of it, but also grasp the entire vision as a whole. Right.
Yeah, so he would never let it down. Both sides, basically.
Yeah. So we never saw him was like, oh, everything will be all right, guys. He never saw him be like, guys, we're all fucked. You know, it was very much a temper headed. the ideal way of dealing with visions. Let's put it that way. Yeah.
So naturally, when Big E shows up, he knew it was going to happen. And Sanguinius saw every consequence that could come from, hey, I'm, you know, now you have this secular being that has decided to go the absolute non-secular way. And he lands on this planet to find his son. And now his son is being worshipped as a literal god.
Awkward.
So yeah, very awkward. To the point of where Sanguinius fell to his knees begging for the lives of his followers. And the emperor actually gave it to him. He kept the imperial truth from Baal Secundus and made sure that no ship would land on the moon save Sanguinius himself.
There we go. That's a pretty good compromise. I like
that. Yeah, I feel like that was a pretty good compromise. Well, I mean, Sanguinius kind of was the second favorite.
Yeah, very much so.
In all honesty.
Oh, yeah, yeah. To be honest, I do agree with, I think it was Horace who said it, that fucking Sanguinius should have been War Master.
He probably did say it. Because him and Sanguinius, we talk about the Primarchs, like, occasionally have other Primarchs they either hate or are really close to. Sanguinius and Horus were tight. They were
Sanguinius and Horus were fucking besties.
Because I think it was I think Horus was talking to Logan. He was
yeah, I want to say it was Vengeful Spirit. They were doing like a fucking flashback, and he was talking
because he was talking about how he knew the Lion wanted the War Master position because the Lion is just, you know, an egotist and everything like that. Mm-hmm. And Dorn wanted it, but not for any, like, Dorn wanted it because he thought he was the better fit for it. Lion wanted it because he thought he was better than everybody. And he's like, I do believe that Sanguinius should have been War Master and not me.
Because he didn't want it. Because he didn't want any responsibility. He really didn't want to be put in any kind of seat of power. He didn't want to be seen as above anybody else.
All Horus wanted, to be honest, was just to fight along his dad. Like, he was jealous that he had other brothers because it was just him and Big E for the longest time. But yeah, I do agree with him that Sanguinius should have been War Master. But I think Big E did that for a reason.
Oh, but there were so many important things for him to do when he left.
Yeah, well,
God, I want us to do an Emperor episode so bad.
Big E and the Milkman, so him and the Malkador.
Yeah. Now, what's important to know is the introduction to the Revenants, right? So whenever he goes around, what normally would happen is that, whenever the Primarchs were found, they would initially go away for studying and tutoring and everything else before they actually met with the Legion. So that happened to Sanguinius, and he spent a very, very long time also with Horus, and he actually shadowed the Luna Wolves, later the Sons of Horus, and that's where he developed basically his friendship with Horus, as well as with, like, the First Company, Abaddon, eventually Loken, and all the others, like Little Horus Aximand, right? All these named very big characters that we talk about, the Horus Heresy, that these are instrumental in defining the universe, yeah? And it got to the point to where actually when he's finally, after so many years of working with this other Legion, understanding their tactics, everything else, he's heard the stories about the Revenants, okay? And he's a little bit sketched out because one hand he's going, these are my sons, but on the other hand, what if they reject me? And that almost seemed to be, because I want to say this flashback happens at one of the books in Siege of Terra, if I remember correctly. Maybe I'm wrong. But whenever he's on that ship, he actually confides with Abaddon saying, what am I going to do if my children reject me, right? What if I'm not as successful as Horus? Because at this point, Horus being like the officially first found was going around and sort of running around and, you know, being successful, right? He already has Legion. He had the infrastructure, everything else. It was a go time. And over here, he had to basically pick up the remnants of these horrible, just berserker type savages and saying, what the fuck am I going to do? And he eventually gets off the ship and all the entire Revenant Legion is boom. Okay.
I want to say it was raining too. I want to say it was, you know, one of those standard, like, in the middle of the night, it's fucking piss pouring rain, and you've got like this fucking big old mercenary band that's just fucking standing there full gear, full attention.
Yeah, and it was very awkward for Sanguinius as well as Legion, because the Legion, obviously at this point you have other Primarchs and their introduction is always different, right? So Sanguinius studied the speeches the other Primarchs gave when they first met the Legion, and the Legion themselves, the Revenants, are like, he could come over here and say we're a failure and kill us all, right? As we later see with Perturabo and all that stuff.
Right. So, I mean, they saw that with Kurz and all them, didn't they?
Well, also, too, like, a lot of, yeah, because whenever, that was the feeling among the Revenants, whenever we get their point of view, is them saying, hey, we don't know what's going to happen. Because some Primarchs, yeah, when they meet the Legion, we're talking, the Legion gets fucked up, right? People get killed, everything else entirely restructured. Is he going to be a father, a leader, a dictator, an executioner for us? Like, how's this going to go?
We don't know what we're getting out of
this.
Yeah,
we don't. Yeah. But he did, Sanguinius did something that no other Primarch had ever done. And it's fucking amazing, actually, just listening to it. Like you said, everybody was gathered up. He was giving a speech. And he pledged an oath to the Legion.
He actually got on his knees before.
Did he
the
really?
He kneels before the Legion and pledges to them and says that you are my sons and I will fight for you.
Yeah, and he hoped that he could be worthy of leading them and live up to their standards and so like live up to leading him or the sons.
Is there a speech? It's Sanguinius. There's probably a speech.
Oh, there are
probably.
I guarantee you, if it's Sanguinius, there's a speech somewhere.
Yeah, basically that he hoped he could live up to leading them, and that no matter what the fuck happened, whether it was glory or damnation, he would stand with them. But yeah, for a Primarch to be reunited with his Legion, and immediately that Primarch doesn't make them pledge an oath. He pledges an oath to them. That's some shit. Like, that is humility and just humbleness at its fucking peak.
Oh, yeah. Absolutely.
Just to give an example, I'll read out the first part if you want to keep on looking, and you can add on to the later end. The first thing he does, instead of giving the bombastic speech everybody's expecting, right? He just walks up, and then he asks the closest Revenant, and he says, what is your name? And at that point, the warrior responds, Idonis, right? And Sanguinius just replies with, thank you. Which is fucking huge. The first thing, when you step off as a Primarch, okay, which you have full rights as a Primarch. And I know that was like less than a sentence of dialogue, but that sets the tone for everything for the Legion going forward.
Oh, yeah.
Because at this point, we're talking, some Legions are always viewed by others with different stuff, right? So the Revenants were down there at the very bottom. We're saying probably worse than the Night Lords, worse than anybody else. Like, they were the cannibals. They were the, like, sick fucks, okay? Yeah. Nobody wanted to work with them. They were not worthy of anything, okay? From everybody's point of view, they thought, oh, my God, we're about to get wiped out by the Imperium because we're fucking up. We're not doing too good. They view us with distaste. And the first words out of your father's mouth is, what is your name? And then you just say it. You're like, why is he asking? Oh, Lord, what's he going to do? And he just says, thank you. The amount of the bond that is formed in that instant and through the rest of this is absolutely just insane. And it's hard to put into words just to let you guys know how big of a deal that is. And it shows so much about Sanguinius' character that he goes around to a lowly legionary. It doesn't have to be, it wasn't the captain. It wasn't like the legion master in Sanguinius' loo. It was a random ass soldier. And he said, thank you. So just beautiful. This is why Sanguinius is one of the best. I don't play Blood Angels. Maybe one in the future, but by God, Sanguinius is
good. Dude, the Blood Angels were like the first army that I had fallen in love with in this, in just the game, not even the lore. Like, I saw them, I was like, dude, those guys are fucking awesome. My favorite color is red. Those guys look badass. And I learned more about them. I was like, oh, these guys are, I mean, the ignorant me at the time, like, these guys are kind of like just basically vampires, but they have this like awesome aesthetic about them. They're cool as shit. They're fucking tanks and everything are fucking awesome. Their Primarch is cool as shit. And I'd fallen in love with them. And then I learned about the World Eaters. And I'm like, that guy over there, that's more like me than this guy. But still, freaking, Blood Angels will always have a fucking spot in my heart.
Yeah, so after the whole meeting, it actually leads to one campaign that I guess I'll note. The Blood Angels have so many. Tegar Pentaurus, and that's actually where Sanguinius actually proves his mettle to the Legion. Sanguinius actually ends up taking the pelt of a Carnadon. Is that the big thing that's actually on his?
I have no idea.
Look, holy shit!
I'm not sure. You pulled it up and said, "Holy shit!"
Yeah,
so I'm assuming
it's like a fucking okay. Take a tiger, take a male lion.
It's a liger.
Right? Is it like the cheetah? Is it the cheetah thing that's on his fucking, that's on the pelt that's on his?
And then combine that with a saber-toothed tiger. Huh. It's almost like a Calibanite lion, but with stripes and a giant mane. And
once again, the lion is second place in him.
You may be first in the legions, but you're last in everyone's heart.
Even in the heat of battle, Sanguinius notices a spark of nobility in them. They fight to grasp, you know, to grasp fickle favor and victory, not simply for slaughter. And there's actually a cool little quote that leads to them getting their name. It says, even though a darkness hangs over them, a future soaked in blood and horror, they are angels yet, angels of blood. And they are the Revenant Legion no more, and they now become the Blood Angels.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
So after that, the Blood Angels split up into companies and join up with the Luna Wolves again to go on best friend adventures.
Buddy cop adventures through the galaxy.
Yeah, buddy adventures. After that, they go on a whole bunch of campaigns and everything, have a whole bunch of fun.
It's important to know during this time they've always had the Black Rage didn't happen until after a Siege of Terra. Okay, but this time they still have the Red Thirst, which is basically whenever they get overwhelmed by wanting to consume blood, the entire vampire deal, they can go basically feral. Okay. Yeah. During this time, Sanguinius is attempting his best to basically quell this as soon as he finds out about it. And also keep it from everybody else that he knows. Because if knowledge of that got out, Sanguinius feared he would end up like the 2nd and 11th Legions, right?
Yeah, he didn't want anything that was gonna... He didn't want anybody to see anything that was gonna see his Legion in a different light.
Yeah, they had to fight for the honor of being the noble Blood Angels that they eventually turned into later in the Horus Heresy.
Well, I guess when your dad looks like an angel Jesus, you kind of have some big shoes to live up to.
Yeah, pretty much, yeah.
And he also, I think this was a way to try and quell the Red Thirst. He was actually one of the other Primarchs, kind of like the Emperor's children, to actively promote his legion in doing extracurricular activities outside of, you know, war.
Oh yeah,
not weed.
Actively wanted them to, you know, paint and, you know, compose. Yeah, that's the word I was looking for.
Yeah, sort of like how the Emperor's children also did similar stuff like that, where if you have all these abilities, right, why just use them for war? Why not also be like the best painter, the best musician, that type of stuff?
Yeah. Right, music, poetry. He wanted them to do something else. Have a
life outside of war. Exactly. Basically.
Yeah. But while this is happening, along with the Red Thirst, is eventually Horus actually found out about what was happening. Relatively recent before the actual Horus Heresy, you know. But that being said, this goes back to Sanguinius and Horus were the closest brothers, okay? And that's why if Horus had one brother, you say would be closest, it would be Sanguinius.
Right.
Which makes their eventual duel that much more impactful. But Horus actually knew about that, so fun fact there, and decided to keep it a secret. And also, I don't know why. Probably because at that point he thought it was unimportant, but also Horus, I like to think this because Horus still held some vestige of friendship with Sanguinius even during the Horus Heresy, all that stuff. Imagine how easy it would have been to leak that info to the Loyalists and saying, oh, by the way, they do this, by the way, right? It's not a weapon. They probably wouldn't have done anything at that time. But if they knew about it, then perhaps after the Horus Heresy, there would have been an entirely different discussion about that or anything else. It would have sowed distrust. But instead, the Loyalists never really find out in a meaningful way, interesting.
Well, Sanguinius was also like Horus's, like one of Horus's first choices to attempt to recruit in the fucking. He really didn't. He really ended up with like the bottom of the fucking barrel whenever he got his fucking. He got his generals, because who he got was definitely not absolutely who he wanted. I want to say what.
Yeah, he ends up saying that, right? Because he basically, I think, towards the end of the Horus Heresy, towards Siege of Terra, He literally makes a mention of that in one of the books, saying, if I could trade out all these people for the loyalists, I fucking would. I got the people I don't really want on my side.
Right. Yeah, I really think the only people he wanted on his team was, I think, Fulgrim and Mortarion at best.
Yeah.
Yeah. He didn't want Sanguinius. He, in fact, wanted Sanguinius to die because he knew that he would never turn.
That leads us to, what's the name of the planet?
Cygnus Prime.
Yeah, that was it. Cygnus Prime. And that is where Erebus decides, hey, you know, why don't we send them over here? And working with the demons, we're going to have them basically be beset by a whole bunch of demons, by all the gods, but especially Khorne. And at that point, they're going to go on ahead and hopefully corrupt Sanguinius.
Right.
Spoiler alert, Sanguinius wins and is alive and actually avoids being destroyed, though it was actually pretty close.
Yeah, the first one was a close one, and then Sanguinius comes back and fucking...
Surprise, motherfucker.
Slaps the shit out of... this is a good time to mention when the demon Cabanda shows up for the first time.
Yeah, so Cabanda works as almost like Sanguinius' demonic counterpart to that. Because reminder, the World Eaters was not Corrin's first choice, right? No offense meant by any means.
No, I mean, I have to secede this, like, I can't really argue it, because... I mean,
Angron wouldn't be my first choice either.
look what you're getting in the World Eaters. For them to achieve the same thing that the Blood Angels have in the Red Thirst, they needed outside help, i.e. the Butcher's Nails.
Oh, I can't wait to talk about World Eaters because I found out some cool shit fucking Emperor Mankind when I read it. They have a section where they have a section where it's the Emperor and an Adeptus Mechanicus priest, like a tech priest, that specializes in this thing. And it's them sitting at the operating table with Angron's head fucking open, like looking at the Butcher's Nails and seeing what they can do and realizing they can't do shit.
Yeah, they couldn't. And there's some interesting shit with the Butcher's Nails too, and how Erebus fucked over. Lorgar. Lorgar.
No, we can blame Erebus. It's fine.
Erebus, Lorgar, that whole fuck that whole legion. Yeah. How they fucked over Angron.
Except however, Arbital, but yes.
Yeah. However, back to Sanguinius and. Yep. So, fun fact, I just read this right now and it's kind of interesting. The reason Horus wanted Sanguinius to die was effectively because not only would his brother never turn to chaos, but Sanguinius was one of the only Primarchs who, if he actually turned to chaos, would have a higher chance, finding greater favor with one of the chaos gods than Horus himself. So where they were propping up Horus to basically be the fifth chaos god or whatever.
Oh, he's cool, but this one has wings.
Yeah, Sanguinius, along with his Red Thirst and shit, would have actually gotten greater favor with not just Khorn, but all the other gods. And Horus would basically become the Lorgar Erebus of
Khorne, yeah. And that would have taken him away from Horus, like you said.
Yeah.
Now, something interesting to note is we also see how, I think we talked about this before, to where Primarchs and the Legion are very much connected in almost like a psychic way, right? To where, like, when a Primarch dies, their Legion, they feel that shit, right? Doesn't matter where you are, you fucking know they're dead. It seems like the Blood Angels is actually a bit tighter than that, to the point to where actually whenever they're fighting on Cabanda does a mighty sweep of his axe and actually kills like 500, like several hundred Blood Angels in one sweep, which is fucking insane, by the way. But it was so many Blood Angels at once that there was actually a psychic backlash onto Sanguinius, which is interesting because we always hear about it going like, oh, Primarch died, Legion felt it.
Yeah.
Now we're seeing so many of the Legion died in 1 second that the Primarch felt it. Which also could go into some of Sanguinius' actions later during Horus Heresy, right? Because he's feeling the pain of his sons.
Yeah. And you also got to think, too, do you think it actually does work both ways? But just the other Primarchs aren't as sensitive to it as, like, Sanguinius would be?
I think so, because all the Primarchs are commanders, and they always have some distance. Like, for example, obviously, I got to use Rogaldorn as an example. Rogaldorn is, at the same time, a commander, and to a very, very inner group, sort of like a father, okay?
Right.
But it's very much, you're in the military, son, grab up your bayonet, okay? For Sanguinius, it seems to be a lot closer. He's commander, but also he's father to all of his sons.
Yeah, Sanguinius was a lot closer with his legion than a lot of the Primarchs was.
Well, I mean, he was the embodiment of the Emperor's like compassion and shit. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So, I mean, that all that checks out.
There's also some epic foreshadowing in the Cygnus campaign, because as he's fighting Cabanda, he's fighting him psychically, and he's fighting, but also he's fighting himself, because inside of himself he notices, and it reads, he notices that there's a red thirst inside of him, but also with the fight and everything that happens with Cabanda and all that, and him getting wounded and then coming back, he notices in the back of his mind that there is a black rage developing.
Just lingering in the shadows.
Yeah, lingering in the back. And so that was pretty much the Cygnus camp. Well, I mean, unless you have more.
I mean, for the most part, that's it, because, I mean, we can't cover it. We'll be here all day if we cover everything. This goes also for our previous episodes and future episodes, right? If you're like, hey, you missed that. Yeah, because we try to keep these under like 2 hours, okay? And usually like an hour to an hour 30.
Yeah, we can keep you guys here for like 5 hours listening off like everything that happens, like all the play-by-plays in the fucking in these campaigns.
Yeah, we're not here to read verbatim. We're here to talk about, give you an overview. Now, if there's a specific campaign, we'll go like in-depth in that video in the future. But
if you want to go in-depth, read the book.
Yeah, fully recommended. It was even better. Pirate the book.
Yeah,
I endorse piracy. Yes.
Yeah. Yeah.
Now, probably the next big thing is going to be Imperium Secundus.
Oh, yes.
And I feel like we got to toss like more details about his foresight into Imperium Secundus. That's like the next big leg of the Horus Heresy, right?
Yeah. Well, that's like Sanguinius's next big leg too.
Before or after they kicked Kurz out into the?
Before. Because Sanguinius is basically the one who did that.
Before, this was before/during.
Yeah. That's what I'm saying. So we just covered Night Lords, and hey, Sanguinius was there.
Yeah, so after the little kerfuffle with the Cabanda, they're like, oh my goodness, it's the heresy, the Horus Heresy, and they, let's get back to Terra, woohoo, and they fucking jump. But of course, the word bearers did this thing called the Ruin Storm, which cut off basically all of Ultramar in that region of space. And they're like, oh no, it's a storm. We got to find safe harbor. And then they skedaddle to where it's not a storm, and that's Imperium Secundus, which Gilman propped up. And he was later named basically Emperor of Imperium Secundus.
I thought he hadn't done it yet. I thought he was like thinking about it. And then Sanguinius came and he was like, perfect.
Pretty much, yeah.
You're talking about when?
Well, it was actually after the Lion got there, because he was the last one to arrive, and that was the deal, because he actually resolved a lot of conflict between Gilliman and the Lion, because at this point they're saying, hey, drop pod party. But that was also because the Lion is an egotist, right? I'm the one who needs to be ruled, and then Gilliman is a little bit also an egotist, truth be told. Okay.
Oh,
and then suddenly they're like, well, if I'm in charge, then you're working for me. And then Lion's like, well, if I'm in charge, you're working for me. And both of us don't like that. Sanguinius arrives and like, hey, we both like Sanguinius. Hey, Sanguinius, you're in charge, Emperor.
Boom. Yeah.
You make I'll some take care of administration. Regent. Lion takes care of the general, and you're the Emperor, because you're like the best of us.
Yeah, because that works out so well. Bro, the Lion. Oh, God. I know we're way past the Lion episode, but he still lets off like the coldest fucking line to Gilliman in one of those books. He fucking looks at him while they're having an they're having an argument, and Gilliman goes on about his theoreticals and practicals, and fucking the Lion looks at him, and he was like, what if I theoretically punch your practical face right now? And I was like, God, yes! And then Sanguinius is like, guys, calm down. Let's stop separating.
Let's chill.
But, so he was definitely the mediator for those two, because those two fucking butted heads so.
Yeah, and similar to his position, in any position, really, he's very reluctant to take this, but also he has the knowledge of saying, I'm the best option. I don't like this. I don't want to be here. But it was me or these two killing each other. It's got to be me, right?
Yeah.
But we'll cover a lot more about Imperium Secundus and Ultramarines. Which is coming up pretty quick.
Yeah, it was Gilliman's idea. He can have that he can have that part of the episode. Yeah.
Exactly, yeah. But the main thing I want to focus on is whenever it comes to Kurz, right? Because at this point, towards the end, Kurz becomes captured. He was done with the dropout party. He was done with trying to kill Gilliman or anything else. And he's captured. And he's quite frankly set for execution. Okay. Sanguinius is a very compassionate individual.
He tried to kill Sanguinius too.
I don't doubt it. Is there anybody he hasn't tried to kill?
Wait, Kurz?
He hasn't tried to kill Russ.
Oh, Kurz?
Only because he didn't get the opportunity to, let's be honest.
Well, let's see. Okay, yeah. If we're talking about who hasn't Kurz tried to kill,
tangent, yeah.
He hasn't tried to kill, well.
That he's come into, like, that he's been close to, or so say. Not like, oh, well, you know, he didn't try to kill Russ because also he never met Russ.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying, because he had never tried to kill Russ.
He didn't want to either.
He'd never tried to kill Alpharius. He'd never tried to kill...
maybe he did and you just didn't know it was Alpharius.
There are so many Alpharius. We'll leave that for that Alpha Legion episode. But who else? He did try to kill Korax.
Yeah, he tried to kill Korax on Isvan.
Yeah.
Did he try to kill Lorgar?
He should
have. He should have. I mean, he saved Lorgar.
He saved Lorgar because Korax was about to fuck him up.
Oh, yeah.
The universe regarded this as a terrible decision.
So, yeah. He's killed Vulcan several times.
Yeah.
But, yeah, I think that's it. Like, he's tried to kill almost every Primarch but any of the traitor ones.
Yeah. So, anyways, enough of that tangent.
That was last episode.
Back to the episode. So, one of the big deals that, like we're talking before about prophecy, right? To where Kurz sort of saw the prophecy and he was being the pessimist and he said, oh, I see the worst in this. That guy is going to try to stab me. And even though I know, like, I can't be killed by this, which someone did correct us in the last episode. It was like, oh, he was going to be stabbed, not shot.
Yeah,
I was like, oh, yeah, that's right, actually, yeah. So a little corrective note there. But obviously, Kurz saw the worst. And that was part of the reason why he got driven insane, right? I mean, if you saw everything in the worst possible way, no fucking wonder you're depressed, right? Sanguinius felt empathy for him because he also had the visions, but he saw the good and bad, but the bad fucking terrified the shit out of him. Yeah. He knew a lot of stuff was coming up and he only saw the worst, and he could very easily see how Kurz would be driven mad by that. Right.
Yeah.
So eventually he goes around and says, hey buddy, come here. Here's like a freshly severed limb as a snack. Let's get in the escape pod. There you go. And sort of like taking old Yeller out, and instead of shooting him, it's like galaxy escape pod, go. Woo. And at that point, Kurz gets ejected at 20 miles an hour into the galaxy.
Go back to the last episode.
Last episode.
At the speed of average human jizz.
And then just kind of, all right, well, that's problem solved.
Adios, motherfucker.
So after that, I'm pretty sure after that, that's when the ruins, that's when the fall of Imperium Secundus, whenever they go, oh, shit. And I'm not sure how that story goes because I haven't gotten there.
The loose quick of it is basically they finally realize that Terra has not fallen. And because Terra's not fallen, that means that what they did right there was a giant waste of time and looks really fucking bad, by the way.
Yeah, that's giant heresy.
Giant. Nobody would have been happy about that. And we'll get more into that in the Gilliman episode. I'm so excited. But at that point, Sanguinius says, GTFO, boys, I'm out of here. And he fucking yeets himself. Like, through the fucking storm, through the galaxy, and hightails into Terra, and that's why it is the Blood Angels, Imperial Fist, and White Scars that are mainly defending Terra, right? So he gets there in time for the Siege of Terra.
Oh, yeah, that's right, because Gilliman and the Lion, don't they leave, like, later?
Yeah, they're like the relief force, right? The Lion and Gilliman both, specifically. In fact, a large detachment of Dark Angels do make it to Terra during the Siege of Terra and defend the Astronomicon. So, the more you know.
Oh, shit, huh.
Yeah. So, that means that he arrives there, and this is whenever stuff starts getting really fucking bad for Sanguinius, okay?
Oh, this is where you get to take over as our recent fucking Siege of Terra expert.
Yeah, maybe. Which, by the way, once again, fantastic books. I cannot recommend them enough. And I know online people will grab it like, I didn't think this book did this. Yeah, it's worth it. Just read it. It's good. Don't let the naysayers keep you down. But Sanguinius, speaking of visions, Sanguinius starts having these awful visions of his own death at the hands of Horus. And both him and Horus always kind of knew that there was going to be a final duel between them to see who wins. And Sanguinius would always see, I am going to die. I am going to die. And that started draining on him to an insane degree, okay? Even as a Primarch, he started getting basically depressed. He zoned out during battles, stuff like that. So randomly, he'd be going around, and he would actually falter in his fighting because he would be plagued by these awful, awful visions, right?
Yeah.
And they got so potent that actually he found out and had a vision one time during a battle where he zoned out and saw a vision of Perturabo standing over his table, orchestrating the siege. And due to that, he actually found out a couple unique things to help defend the wall, because he saw what Perturabo was doing through his eyes. Mm. So, this is a little interesting tidbit. And he actually tries to console with Malcador a little bit and stuff like that, but for the most part, they're unreached, right? Because they're doing Malcador's kind of with the Emperor, they're doing their own little shtick, they don't got time to be bothered. But at the same time, he doesn't want to console into the Khan or Dorne, because first of all, they wouldn't understand, and if they did understand, they would have taken him out of the battle, okay? Because they didn't want him to potentially be a liability or to die, because if you want to break loyalist morale, you put the head of Sanguinius on a spike and you win that battle. Okay.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. So he basically had to suffer all alone up until that final battle.
Bro, can you just imagine Malcador? Like, I don't care if you're seeing your own death. I'm over here fucking feeding the Emperor Zins while he's on the golden throne. Jesus Christ, trying to keep his energy up.
Oh. Bring me the mythical 9 milligram Zin and do it.
So I know this is delayed, but this is the quote that I was talking about earlier where Horace was saying that Sanguinius should have been the War Master.
Yeah.
This was from False Gods.
Ooh,
it says Sanguinius, it should have been him. He has the vision and strength to carry us to victory and the wisdom to rule once victory is won. For all his aloof coolness, he alone has the Emperor's soul in his blood. Each of us carries part of our father within us. Whether it is hunger for battle, his psychic talent, or his determination to succeed, Sanguinius holds it all. It should have been his.
Mm-hmm.
So even Horace was like, dude, I don't know why the fuck dad picked me for this shit. Like, should have given it to the winged asshole right over there.
Yeah. Eventually, the hour comes, right? And it's finally time for the showdown, and we got to spend a decent portion on this, because this is Sanguinius' moment. And he already went ahead and fought Angron. And I'll put a link in the video description to like a cool little animation somebody's doing of like Sanguinius fighting Angron. It's so fucking good. And by the way, if you think he shouldn't have won that, go fuck yourself. They did that in an excellent way. The only downside is that in that fight, although Sanguinius did win, he was mortally wounded. Okay. He was probably about to die unless like he went into fucking like stasis, super hospital 2000 type shit.
Was he hit with the anathema?
No, he wasn't. No, Angron just fucked him up that bad. Yeah.
Oh, no, I was talking about the fight between him and Horus.
Oh, him and Horus? No.
No, because Horus gave the anathema to... Didn't he give it to Lorgar? Or Erebus?
Yeah, no, he gave it.
Wait, he fought Angron first?
Yeah.
Oh, I didn't know he fought Angron.
At the gates, right before the very... Traitors were about to breach the actual final line of defense, Sanguinius stood there with his spear, and single-handedly fought off every single person he could, including Cabanda, and immediately after that, Angron. Just
fucking
one
demon
punch.
Prince and Angron.
Yes.
Basically two demon princes.
Yeah, well, it was also Cabanda, the strongest of Khorne's generals. The strongest. Yeah.
That's
right?
What I'm saying. Wasn't Cabanda a greater demon prince?
Yeah, greater demon prince. Yeah. And then Angron. And he won both.
Golly, holy hell.
Yeah, but the fighting left him mortally wounded, to the point where when the Emperor finally traded places with Malcador on the Golden Throne and said, everybody to the Teleportarium, we have to do this stuff.
Malcador quadruple deck the Zins.
Do it. He actually went ahead and the Emperor tried to get, he said, I am going to bring three of you along with me. I am bringing Dorne. I am bringing, well, shit, I fucked that up. I'm bringing, here's who's coming with me. It is Dorne. Khan was already wounded at this point. As well as Valoris, right? Or no, Valdor. Valdor.
Valdor. Yeah.
And said, all that Sanguinius, Vulcan, stay here. And then Sanguinius was like, what the fuck, bro? And, the Emperor actually went out of his way to say, hey, we have a higher chance of losing, but I don't want you to die. And that's one of the biggest moments of empathy from the Emperor to one of his sons. So we go to say, hey, the Emperor used his sons as a tool. Yeah. But he showed genuine compassion to Sanguinius, because what man who viewed a tool would say, I don't want you to go and help me win the day, right? You don't leave your strongest tool out of the deck that you're going to use if it's life or death. He showed genuine compassion saying, hey, I don't want you to die. You're already basically mortally wounded.
Well, yeah, I was about to say, if my best tool has a giant nick in it, I definitely wouldn't want to fucking use it.
Yeah, but when it's all or nothing. Yeah.
Big E almost seems like Mr. Miyagi in the Karate Kid movie, like the first one. You're like, man, he's being a real dick. And it's like, oh, no, he's teaching him something. He's teaching him karate and lessons and
Holy
stuff.
Holy shit, he's learning karate from painting this fence.
Yeah, it's like, oh shit, Big E was actually compassionate, but he's doing it in a dick way. It's like,
Yeah.
I get it. Okay.
Well, you do know there is a lot of compassion in the Emperor. However, a lot of it's foreshadowed over the fact of he realizes that there's greater work that needs to be done.
Oh, of course.
And you can the Emperor Mankind book. Yeah. Fucking you can see how much all that shit fucking weighs on him, like as he's going through these visions with this custodian of him just showing him shit throughout his life and being like, I don't have a choice, man. This is what I have to do to keep everybody safe.
Right.
Yeah. He denied himself the pleasure, right, of anything. Because, reminder, the Emperor is still a mortal human, right? He is not a Primarch. He's not Astartes. He is a regular-ass human. And as humans, we have a tendency to get attached to anything we fucking like. Pet rocks. Look at that. Okay.
Regular human.
For the most part, right? In the sense of he was a amazing Super Saiyan Z type psyker, but at the same time, he was still a human, right? He wasn't post-human, transhuman, anything else like that. But at that point, eventually, the quotation marks by Groot, okay? But
can we animate me some quotation marks for that?
Yeah. Well, I'll do my best. I think I've got limited patience depending on where I'm at the editing, so we'll find out.
That's a no.
But eventually, Sanguinius fights his way all the way up to Horus's chamber. Right?
Fucking we ball!
And before he walks in there, the first thing he encounters is actually the ghost of Ferris Manus. And in fact, he encounters the ghost of all the dead Primarchs, including those that ascended to demonhood. And he said, and Ferris basically had a talk saying, the next time I see you, you're going to be at Horus's side. Or, you're going to see Horus and be fighting with him, but that's whenever you'll see me next. But just know that what you're doing is right. And I won't go too far into details because it's a really good moment. I can't fully capture it. But just being said, it was a very nice, heartwarming thing. So yeah, Ferris is essentially alive in spirit, along with all the Primarchs who died or anything else, right? Because even Alpharius or Omegon, whoever you want to say it was, showed up in that little ghost segment.
It was Alpharius.
It's one of those two assholes.
It's one of those two.
Yeah. Like legit one of those two assholes, not like a legionnaire who had his blood and became Alpharius for the time being.
It's a random fucking tactical marine that's a force ghost.
Yeah, because that's what's going on right now in Deliverance Lost. Freaking Alpharius basically mind wiped one of his legionnaires, gave him his blood, and then the entire time that he's infiltrated Korax's legion, again, the narrator is calling him Alpharius.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
And Omegon is off on one of the other things.
Yeah.
Yeah. He's off on one of the other planets coordinating with him and shit like that.
Yeah.
So, yeah, it's a random ass tactical marine.
Hey, it's Jerry. I remember you.
I'm not Jerry. I'm Alpharius.
Yeah. Holy shit. These are Primarchs. How did I get here?
Guys, I shouldn't be here, guys.
I think I zigged when that shit has zagged. Fuck.
Keep the helmet on. I'm Alpharius.
But he goes in, and the first thing that happens is Horus does a very fascinating thing, and that he tries to go and finally win Sanguinius over. He knows it's probably not going to work, but at this point, we're talking about super chaos corrupted Horus, and he has before him, he has five thrones. He has one for him in the middle, and then he has one for each of the chaos gods. And he tried to go and convince Sanguinius to actually join up with Nurgle, believe it or not.
That's a weird ass fucking.
Because Sanguinius feared his death, and who gives life but Nurgle?
Oh,
I mean, fair, but that's can you really call that life?
Well, exactly. That's sort of like the debate right there. But going back into this, it also plays at his greatest fear. And going back into not going to delve too deep into this, but it's worth mentioning because we always call him Space Jesus or anything else. Interesting parallel that gave Sanguinius is that in the books leading up to Jesus's crucifixion in the Bible, you see that he starts losing his mind about his own death, right? Nobody wants to be killed that way. Right. And he's very depressing, but he does it because of duty. And then we look at Sanguinius and it's the same deal, right? And that's what makes the offer so tempting, saying, you don't want to die. That's the last thing you want to fucking do, okay? But if you join me, all you have to do, say you will follow me, sit in the seat, you're good. That's all he had to do. Sanguinius still says no. And he ends up fighting Horus, and he actually delivers so many lethal wounds to Horus that if Horus was not also
amplified by the power of all the chaos gods,
like mortally, he killed Horus. Yeah. And that was part of the reason they were talking about is because Horus was so powerful. If you just killed you had to kill Horus psychically as well as physically,
right?
Because if you killed one and not the other, he's not dead. And that's why the Emperor
And that's exactly what Biggie did.
Exactly, yeah. But the entire time,
fucking obliterated his life force.
Yeah, after playing Yu-Gi-Oh. Yeah. But the entire thing, and this is moderately funny, but the entire time from Sanguinius's point of view is he's fighting for his life, right? Barely holding on. He's over there. He's doing this and that. He's doing everything perfect. He stabbed Horus mortal wounds 20 times. Like, he's going to go down any second now. The day's going to be saved. And then when you see Horus's point of view, he doesn't even realize Sanguinius is there. And he's like, oh, I'm bleeding. No, I'm not. Huh. I feel like somebody's flying around me.
Motherfucker's making us feel no pains right now.
Yeah, pretty much, yeah. And then
brother,
he's like,
you can never defeat me in the power of my nose hose.
And the entire time Sanguinius is fighting for his life, max speed. Horus is like doing a thinker, like the statue. And he's like, oh, poor Sanguinius, if only you knew, I will have to go and squash your life force. And eventually, Horus actually goes into gear and basically fucking smashes Sanguinius. And then proceeds to literally crucify him in the corner. Yeah.
Damn.
Yeah. Fucking savage. That being said, of course, this is whenever the Black Rage comes into play. And in the moment he dies, all the Blood Angels on Terra go fucking apeshit, right? And it's going to carry over into like modern day 40K and every time frame since this happened. Is that all these people believe that they were... They just lost their shit, right? They thought they were Sanguinius, they were fighting Horus, everything else. And they attacked friend, they attacked foe, everything else. A lot of blood angels during that time frame died, but not due to traitors, but due to loyalists. Because guess whose ranks they're within whenever they do this? It's the Imperial Fist, the White Scars, everybody else. And the next thing you know, they have to say, oh my goodness, were they traitors the entire time, waiting for the right time to strike? And they have to end up putting down a lot of Blood Angels, right?
Nice try, Horus, but you activated my trap card.
Waltz around, go.
Black Rage, go.
Yeah, and that's sort of the end of it, so to say, for Siege of Terra, everything else. But it's important to note is that he did see Ferris Manus the Skull, okay? So he was right about that, and if what we learned is anything to go by, he's somehow, in like a weird you're dead sort of way, he is alive, okay?
In a weird you're dead sort of way.
Yeah. And that leads us on to, which we'll talk about later, the Sanguinor. Yeah, that's a different talk. But the Black Rage. Yeah. So anytime from that day forward, if a Blood Angel will also feel, or any successor chapters will feel, the Red Thirst, right? They want to go and consume the blood of their enemies and go feral. If they have a Black Rage, they feel like they are Sanguinius fighting Horus, and they will do that to anybody. And the power of disbelief is so strong that they'd be fighting Tyranids. They still think they're Horus, right?
Right.
Yeah, Horus or legionaries or whatever else, but they're fighting to in that final battle.
So what happens? What happens when a Blood Angel who's suffering the effects of the Red Thirst slips into the Black Rage?
I think the Black Rage overrides it. Yeah.
It does. Yeah. So basically, once they fall into the Black Rage, it is almost fucking impossible to bring them back.
Yeah.
Anyone who succumbs to the Black Rage is effectively removed once they're calmed down. Because apparently, I guess it's only like a chaplain that can calm them.
Yeah.
And once they succumb to the Black Rage, if I'm not mistaken, and please correct me in the comment time, but once they succumb to the Black Rage, they can't go back to their normal companies or whatever. They in fact get put into the Death Company.
Correct.
And Death Company, now can you imagine, okay, you got all your brothers over here, they have real bad anger problems when you piss them off, right? Then you got these guys over here who are fucking psychos, the likes of which would make curves like, oh shit, that seems a little excessive.
So do Death Company try to kill each other too?
No, not each other. That's like the only friendlies they have is each other, but everybody else, including other Blood Angels, everybody else. Yeah, free game.
Yeah. So when Death Company is deployed, they're basically deployed away from their or ahead, I should say, of their brothers.
Why do they all look like Sanguinius? Yeah. Why do they all look like Horus?
Yeah. And there's a chaplain, I think. If I'm not mistaken, I think a chaplain.
One chaplain who came back from the Black Ridge.
Yeah. And Lamarty's.
Yep.
Yeah. And apparently a chaplain's the only one who can like corral them after the battle's done and shit. So they're just like, oh, Red Rage, Black Rage, activate. And then just, all right,
So depending upon going, since we're now past like actual horse heresy time frame, we're going to do kind of like a jump to modern day 40K. Okay. Mm. So one of the main things we're talking about is with the Black Rage, like you said, they have to be corralled. Specifically for Blood Angels, they're kept at, they're basically their base on Baal Secundus, and they're literally in a giant tower that's just a prison. And the entire time, if you go in there, you can hear them howling, screaming, thrashing, everything else, day in, day out, right? Now, for the Red Thirst, something I want to bring up is something we actually learned recently. Spoilers for the Beckwind trilogy, last book to be released hopefully soon, is that we found out is that actually, if you are, if you fall to the Red Thirst, you can actually be cured of the Red Thirst.
Like cured, or just like
a seemingly cured.
Really?
We're unknown if it's a this one specific character was cured, but it seems to be a universal rule. No, and that's if you have a pariah. If a pariah comes in and cuts them off from the warp, they regain their senses. Yeah.
That makes sense.
Yeah. So the more you know.
So all you got to do is just, what? Okay. So if that's the case, then that, why not just get like a squad of Sisters of Silence?
That's been the question. But also, they are exceptionally rare. If they are in the Sisters of Silence, they're usually doing something else. And when they follow the Red Thirst, odds are they're in battlefield combat. Mm. Meaning that whenever they follow that, there's no real way to like evac them to an ambulance or some shit. If say, quick, sister, go over there. It's like, hey, if you follow the Red Thirst, you're probably going to end up dying in that battle, right?
Yeah, so it's either that or keeping a detachment of Sisters of Silence, which is then keeping a detachment of another rare resource of gnolls with you.
Yeah, and they're so rare, they may not have found that out until, like, this one specific incident in Beckwind. Yeah.
And I'm assuming it's because Beckwind was near him?
Yep, it was Beckwind,
Yeah.
I don't know, I'm thinking...
Well, actually, she encountered a single lone feral blood angel and attacked her, but the moment he got within the range... Yeah, he literally went from like, I'm gonna kill you, and that she at the moment she had a collar, which turned that the null stuff off basically, and then she happened to flip it off, saying worst case scenario, you know, what the fuck am I gonna lose? I'm gonna die. And flipped it off to disorient him, and the next thing you know, as soon as it stops, he just like, oh shit, picks up a cup of tea, my lady, I'm so sorry for my previous transgression.
Yes, blood angel. No. God, that's one thing I cannot stand is how fucking snobby some of these audiobook guys make the fucking blood angels, how they're all
Now granted, here's something interesting, because we do not know if this is a unique case or universal. It seems to be universal, but this guy's also a unique case, because this blood angel, who had apparently been in the Red Thirst and all this stuff for a very, very long time, because he was like hidden in like a deep, deep, dark undercity, like nobody else around for literally like the entire planet. He also had wings, like sanguineous wings. That's not a thing.
Well,
yeah,
we've said in the last episode that there are certain, maybe like one out of, you know, 10,000 whatever individuals who actually inherit their father's gift. So
they do, but. Also, in all recorded history for Blood Angels, whether it's Horus Heresy up to M41, 42, we've only seen one person, and that's him. So either it's like rare, but even like one in 20 million or some shit, or it's like something happened to make this guy unique. So whatever we know about the Blood Angels when it comes to the Red Thirst, Black Rage, there's more to be explored. Yeah.
That's interesting.
It's Sanguinius reincarnated.
Maybe. You never know.
Well, you know, Jesus died and then, you know, rose from the dead 3 days later, so maybe that was Sanguinius.
No, maybe this guy's Joseph Smith. He found the golden talent.
He was in a cave too.
He was in a cave.
He was in a cave. Yeah, yeah.
They could've just... we're gonna get like space Utah soon. Holy shit. But anyways, so going straight from that, the Blood Angels obviously adopted the Codex Astartes, but to, well, yes and no, right?
I thought they
Really. They really didn't, but they were. They did limit themselves in numbers.
I was about to say, I thought they're one of the Angels of Death companies.
Yeah, correct. Yeah, I kind of correct myself. I have to correct myself on that. Yeah, they didn't really follow the Codex Astartes. They are 100% not Codex compliant, but they did agree with the number stuff, sort of similar to Space Wolves, right? Not Codex compliant, but saying, okay, to appease the peace, we're still going to keep our numbers around like 1,000.
Right.
And they made the successor chapters. And this is where it gets interesting, because Blood Angels are regal and noble and everything else. And a lot of their successor chapters are fucked up. Fucked up, fucked up.
Do you want me to?
I do.
Yes. All right. Oh. There's a lot.
Oh, I'm aware. I am fully aware.
All right, boys.
A lot of them are now dead, by the way.
Huh?
A lot of them are now dead, by the way.
Oh, that's cool.
Yeah.
You want to, do you know which ones are dead?
Not off the top of my head. No.
Oh, go ahead. Oh. All right. So starting off, we have the Absolvers. Why did I put quotation? Whatever.
Suspected, maybe.
I don't know. We have the Absolvers. We have the Angels in Carmine, the Aetherian, Excelsius. Oh, okay. Oh, the Angels in Carmine, the Angels Aetherian, the Angels Excelsius, the Angels Glorious, the Angels Numinous, the Angels Penitent. That's why I put those, because they were all the angels of something. The Angels Resplendent, the Angels Sanguine, the Angels Vermilion, the Angels of the Light, the Angels of the Grail, the Atlantean Spears.
Oh, hallelujah, we're out of angels. Thank God.
Yeah, we're out of the angels. The Atlantean Spears, Dragons, the Blood Drinkers.
I have something to say about those guys. It's pretty interesting.
Okay. The Blood Eagles, the Blood Legion, the Blood Scythe, the Blood Swords, the Blood Wings, the Brothers of Gerard, the Brothers of the Red, the Burning Blood, the Carmine Blades, the Charnel Guard, which are unrecognized, the Crimson Knights, the Crimson Legion, the Crimson Swords, the Cruor Blades. Fun fact, Cruor is Latin for blood.
Who would have guessed it?
The Death Wardens, the Disciples of Blood Dragons, the Ardent Exsanguinators, the Flesh Eaters, another cool ones, the Flesh Terrors, another cool one. The Golden Sons, the Grail Guard, the Knights of Blood, the Knights of Chalice, the Knights Sanguine, the Lamenters. Oh, the Lamenters are blood angels?
Yeah, I didn't know that. Yeah, no, they're getting a special shout out in a second.
Weird that they're freaking yellow.
Yeah.
It's the best color. What can I say?
Yeah, I don't know.
The Red Knights, the Red Seraph, the Remnants, the Ruby Crescents, the Sable Brotherhood, the Sable Knights, the Sanguine Hosts, the Scions of Sanguinius, the Sons of Sanguinius, and the Templars of Blood.
Are we done?
Yeah, we're done.
Oh, thank God. No, okay, shit. Say your thing, and we're going to have to cover a few of those.
Have fun with all your pictures.
Oh, God.
Well, yeah, the blood drinkers thing also falls into the Legion flaw, the genetic flaw of the Legion and stuff like that. So, essentially, with the blood drinkers, they have a rite called the Rite of Holos, where they start by drinking the blood of that's donated to them by their serfs, and then end the ceremony with eating a prisoner alive. It's like, apparently the death of that one prisoner is more satisfying than blood from 100 serfs. Oh. So, neat thing with the blood drinkers.
Did I miss someone?
Yeah, I think you did. You say flesh terrors?
Yeah.
Okay, okay. That was mainly it. Yeah. On it.
And then the Legion flaw. Well, we all know about the whole drinking blood thing. Yeah. So, apparently, they all suffer from that psychological need to drink human blood. It's called the Red Thirst. They don't have any real nutritional need for the blood, but if they stop drinking it for a long time, they grow weaker and even age.
That just sounds like the Red Thirst. It just sounds like a creepy dude's fucking menstruation kink.
you're probably
you got to get red wings for induction. Yeah. That's how it goes. Yeah.
That's get your blood wings.
Yeah.
So, son, let me tell you how we first you must go into this bedroom with this man.
So a perfect example is Dante. Dante stopped drinking blood for centuries, and he eventually developed wrinkled skin and white hair, right? And basically became kind of like an old man. And he just felt psychologically worn out. So when Baal was attacked,
have that on them big chops.
Yeah. And so when Baal was attacked by the Tyranids in M41,
we'll get there.
He apparently was too emotionally and physically exhausted to lead the defense. But then he drank the blood of one of his servants, and actually he basically went, you ever seen the movie Blade at the end when he's drinking the chick's blood, he almost kills her. Well, this happened, except he actually killed the sir.
As you do in 40K.
Yeah. And was immediately rejuvenated both physically and mentally. However, there's also another setback to the Red Thirst. So if you don't resist the Red Thirst at all, you'll eventually mutate into a monstrous form with fangs and a bat-like face and walk on all fours like a gorilla.
Isn't it almost kind of like how Mephiston ends up, because I know they have one character in fucking out of the Blood Angel. I want to say it's Mephiston.
Mephiston, the librarian.
I believe so.
That looks all fucking looks all super vampire-y with the long fangs and the.
I believe so, because I believe his shtick. Now I will preface this. If you want to look it up to verify this, Blood Angel characters, they have a lot of them. They are not my specialty. So if I'm mistaken, correct me in the comments, or you can correct me right after this. But I believe he's the guy that basically recovered from the Red Thirst, similar to how the chaplain recovered from the Black Rage. He's sort of like the Red Thirst version of that. So he's still vampire-y and also one of the first Primaris sculpts we got that was like Legion specific, right?
Cool fucking model too.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, Mephiston's dope.
Yeah, so we also got to talk about
Mephiston is the chief librarian of the Blood Angels and the only Blood Angel ever to overcome the Black Rage. Before taking on the name of Mephiston and the title Lord of Death, he was originally known as Brother Calistarius. So he was the one who overcame the Black Rage.
Also, the Flesh Terrorists was a really big and popular successor chapter. And they are, okay, if we want to talk about the Blood Angels, the nobility with the darkness, right? Everything, Flesh Terrorists are fucking berserkers. We're talking, they are the, like, equivalents for World Eater berserkers. Okay, I'm saying... Yeah.
Were they started by what's his face? The original, the Flesh Terror dude?
They were, yes.
Oh, nice.
Yeah. And they were almost excommunicado until basically this one guy called Gabriel Seth also brought in some stuff. And there's a really cool book. And I know this because the guy who used to run the local Warhammer shop would constantly talk about the shit. He loved Blood Angels. And there's one short story dealing with Blood Angels it was Flesh Terror hunting down. Like a gene stealer cult thing, right? And then at that point, they finally go through these underhive, everything else, trying to find the patriarch of the gene stealer cult. And eventually he gets there and it's like one remaining guy. And then he finally meets and he talks with the patriarch. And the patriarch goes and says along the lines of, "We are monsters beyond your imagining. We are here to consume your world. And what are you but a mere mortal to go and stand before us?" And then he just sort of looks at them and smiles and says, "I brought monsters too." And then he had a fucking teleportarium or a teleport beacon in his hand. And then suddenly a whole bunch of Death Company just teleport in there and fucking just tear him apart.
Can you imagine an entire company of just Sly Marbo screaming?
Oh God, dude. The last one I really want to talk about is going to be the Lamenters. Because the Lamenters. Oh, the poor Lamenters, dude. Lamenters. God. The Lamenters is part of the 13th Curse Founding. They have a unique thing to where they do not suffer the Red Thirst. Fun fact.
Really?
Yeah, because they apparently something happened, and they experimented to try to get rid of it. And I don't know how, who's involved. I don't know the fucking details. I don't think anybody knows. But
so I guess they came out, and it was lucky in some way.
It's like, hey, this is perfect. We got rid of something that's been haunting us for the past like however many thousand years. And then they get out there, and instead they're cursed with the worst fucking luck imaginable. I do mean actually luck as a weapon. They are cursed with it. If they need their bolsters to work, they will jam. If they need their allies to be with them, they will not show up. If they're traveling through the warp, good fucking luck. I'm saying
they traded in the Red Thirst and the Black Rage for the opposite of that chick Domino from X-Men.
Unironically, yeah.
It's like, I make my own luck. Well, we do too, but it's shitty.
Exactly, yeah. But it gets to the point where during the Bad Ab War, which we'll cover in a different topic, really cool, by the way, they actually show up and they're fighting, and other Space Marine chapters refuse to fight along with them and abandon them because they're that unlucky and said, "We're not getting caught up in this. Good fucking luck."
God. Yeah. I can see why they're called the Lamenters now. Hey, we're cured. We're not angry anymore, but we're not sad.
Their war cry is, I got to pull this up real quick.
What's their war cry? God, I hope this works.
Yeah, pretty much, yeah. For those, it was something like, I'm just going to paraphrase this so I don't have to look it up. For those we love and those on Terra, we cherish and die in glory.
Hold on, I'll look it up.
It was something like that.
So what you're saying is that's the first wave that you send as a distraction while you come around the side and actually do the work.
Yeah, pretty much. I just want to get too close to them, man.
God.
Unironically, bad juju. Yeah.
So they have.
Oh, sorry. For those we cherish, we die in glory.
For those we cherish, we die in glory.
I'm just saying, we're going to die in glory the moment you charge. Like, yeah, but I prefer not to die. So how's this working?
Well, you know what? When you know you're that's, you know what? That's some good positivity. I would say that because they know they're going to die because their shit's not going to work and they're going to miss every shot that they take.
Yeah, to make the most out of it.
Yeah. So they're like, look, we're going to die, but we're going to do it for you. It's like, how about no? How about you just get somebody who won't die and can do it for us at
please,
the same time?
Just sit in the guard, please. Let that be their battle cry.
Yeah.
So the main thing we are going to have to talk about is recently there's been two major lore developments with Blood Angels. The first one is their little kerfuffle with the Tyranids right before and during when the Sacratrix Maledictum opened. And the second one is Dante meeting the lion, okay, which is significantly shorter. So whenever, long story short, Tyranids were coming across around like the Baals sector, okay, and they were clearly making their way towards it. And this is the first time we actually see the Tyranids show something that isn't just base primal action, so to say, because the way it's stated in the books is that if the Tyranids were just going after pure biomass,
yeah,
they would have left the Blood Angels. There was no reason to go after Baal and to wipe out the Blood Angels. But instead, they purposely redirect their forces to attack Baal, which is interesting, because since when did animals hold a grudge? You know what's unique about humans?
Yeah.
Humans are the only animals on Earth that hate, that will hate somebody that they've never met or anything else. Animals, regular ass animals, they don't do that. The Tyranids hated, and they went after Baal.
One animal.
Raccoons don't count.
No.
Oh.
Wasps?
Fucking geese.
Oh, geese. Yeah.
Well, geese are just spawn of Satan anyway, so.
Yeah. Yeah, fucking geese. Doesn't matter. You could just walk by, mind your own fucking business, and a goose will attack you because it's a piece of shit.
Did I tell you, I went around and I like wanted to attack a goose for one of the times I was given the Commodore a model?
Should have done it.
No, I was doing this thing because whenever I really got into it, I was doing the like the videos for the models I was putting out as commissions, mainly for the Commodore. I forget what this was, but I wanted to do like little interviews. And so I actually interviewed one guy that we know named Stone Gray, and I was going to go on Discord and I was going to go and splice that in. And it was supposed to be I forget the theme I was going along with it, but it was supposed to be like, I can't find the answers anywhere because nobody will tell me the answers. Oh, look, here's Magnus. He gives me the answers. It was supposed to be comedic. Just trust me on that. But one of the people I interviewed is I was going back from my job and I stopped at Taco Bell and there was a flock of geese in the parking lot.
Please tell me you still have this video.
I'm not sure if I delete it or not. I have to go through my phone. Oh, but what I did is I went to Taco Bell. I got some chips and then I went out there and I slowly approached the geese. And the idea was if I could find one alone, I was going to feed it the chip, interview it, and when it gave me the answer, I would go and grab it by the neck and fucking run off with it. Regrettably, these geese were smart enough. They did not separate. So I still went up, and I recorded, and the entire time, it was just like really big parking lot. And then I saw a whole bunch of people staring at me, probably thinking like, oh, he's dead. And then I feed it the chip, and like I lose hold of my hand, he fucking snaps it on my thing, and I started like recording, asking him questions about like Warhammer or some shit like that. And then eventually he just doesn't do anything. And I'm like, I don't want to grab you because there's like 20 other buddies. There's a very large pack of geese. If I do this, I'm in trouble. So I end up pussing out. I'm like, nah, never mind. And just fucking left.
So had the plan gone, you know, accordingly, and you managed to grab a goose.
Yeah.
What the fuck were you going to do with
it? I don't know.
You're just going to put it in the passenger seat?
I'm just going to run off with the goose. Yeah. They at least don't want you to know this. The geese at the park are free. You can just go there and take one. I got 20 geese in my apartment right now.
Yeah, you just have to fight for the goose. That's it.
Yeah.
You
win it in combat.
It's a trial by combat.
Exactly.
And the loser goes home with it.
Exactly, yeah. Oh, that's what it was. I was painting Magnus, and it was supposed to be looking for the answers, and then you find a lightsmith. So it was going to be a giant cult uprising, and I planned it to where his chat and all the Discord would also be unionized at the same time. Yeah. Ended up calling that off because I was like, too much work. But
I don't feel like doing that anymore.
Unironically, it was like the day of, and I put in the Discord and I was like, hey, sorry, plans canceled.
I don't feel like running anymore.
Pretty much.
Y'all can go home now.
Yeah.
So I was doing some double checking on the Death Company because, I was actually kind of curious. It's like, okay, how is it that they keep them all in check? And I actually found some interesting information because I've never delved this deep into the Death Company. I've only ever, like, you know, passing lore and shit, but that's it. So it's an interesting way. They actually weed out those who would be easily succumb to the Black Rage beforehand. So effectively what it says is that in order to keep the Black Rage in check, on the eve of battle, the Blood Angels bend their thoughts to prayer and to the sacrifice of their Primarch many centuries ago. The chaplains walk amongst their brethren, blessing each in turn and noting those whose eyes may appear a little glazed, whose speech is slurred or overexcited. Some, almost all, overcome this ancient intrusion into their minds. All of a warrior's training is directed at mastering it, wrestling it down into the depths of his being. But for some, the imprint of Sanguinius is too strong, the memories too loud and demanding. As the chaplains chant the Mori Patris, which is the Mass of Doom, the chosen ones fall into the arms of their priests and are taken away. These join the ranks of a special unit called the Death Company.
Mm-hmm.
So,
okay, so they kind of do like a pre-battle check.
Yeah. So they've already, they're like, look, this, we know this is a fucking issue. Like, all right, we're going to go through and we're going to see who's going to be the new Death Company. Who's going to win this round and shit. And that's interesting. That's interesting to know that it's not just, oh, that guy fell to the Black Rage. All right, keep him over there and then we'll put them in black armor later. No, they do this like the day before. They're like, all right, everybody line the fuck up.
Interesting.
Yeah, that's pretty cool.
But yeah, just to go on back to the Tyranids real quick. So the Tyranids do this. The Blood Angels themselves are not able to go and fully defend from the Tyranids, right? They're like roughly a thousand strong, everything else. So they do what I like to call an Imperial Fist, and they call up all their successor chapters and say, hey, motherfuckers, here's a call to arms. Come to ball, right? And they end up having this giant protracted siege with dozens of Blood Angel chapters, right? And by the end of it, I won't go through to too many details, but long story short, the Sanguinor also shows up during the battle, and it appears to be almost like a holy glowing Sanguinius that shows up whenever it is most needed. And he proceeds to show up to Dante, the chapter master that we talked about. And also, we should have said this before, but Dante's entire attitude is saying, I want to die. Please let me die. Because he's the oldest known space marine. He's like 1,500 years old.
Okay? Yeah.
Well, interesting thing about that is, I actually forgot to mention this before, is Blood Angels actually produce some of the longest living space marine. Like, I mean, as far as life expectancy for a space marine, if they do happen to survive combat and everything, longest lived space marine, and you can actually see that in Dante. Yeah. He is the oldest living space marine. Besides like Bjorn,
yeah,
but
yeah,
Bjorn's,
we're not including dreadnought. We mean like non dreadnought. Yeah,
non interred in a machine in a fucking ambiotic sack.
Yeah, which was super interesting. But while he was sort of going around and basically almost dead and crying out, why am I still alive? Sanguinius, basically the Sanguinor, showed up and said,
yeah,
you have more stuff to do. You got to keep at this. Do your fucking best. And then at that point he leaves.
Oh my God. The fucking, the meme with the fucking, the meme with the NPC, NPC fucking Dante, where he's like, the fucked up NPC.
Why won't you just kill me?
And he's like, I've got more work for you to do. Yeah.
But it was interesting because a couple things happened during that battle. Of course, the Sanguinor. Second thing, while they were invading, the Secretrix Maledictum opened in the middle of the battle. And that actually severed that Hive Fleet from the rest of, you know, the actual Tyranids.
Right.
And therefore, it threw their forces into utter confusion and allowed Blood Angels to win the day. They're gone that. Another special note, the body of Sanguinius was recovered after the Horus Heresy and is in stasis on Baal.
I wonder what they're trying to do with it.
Is that why the Tyranids focused on Baal?
Ooh.
Because imagine if they consumed a Primarch's DNA.
Oh, Lord.
Yeah, yeah.
Consumed a Primarch and used that biomass to become essentially a Primarch Swarm Lord or some shit.
Yeah, think of how bad that would be.
That'd be fucking nuts, because that would add a hell of a lot of sentience and intelligence to an already fucking hive-minded fleet.
And wings.
And wings. Oh, Lord, not more. Yeah.
God.
But that being said, even though the body's in stasis, which whenever something or somebody is in stasis, they are perfectly preserved, right? Time passes outside. It does not affect in any capacity what's inside stasis, okay? Despite this, one of the wounds that Sanguinius has is still leaking blood all the way 10,000 years later. Yeah?
How does he have that much blood?
That's a mystery.
Primarch or not, I don't give a fuck
it
who
is
you
still,
are.
So Sanguinius is still bleeding 10,000 years later.
Is he like the like one of those, like, you see it in especially the Exorcist movies and stuff, like the bleeding statue of Christ and shit?
Yeah,
and
something like that. Yeah.
Like a stigmata?
I'm assuming, yeah. Now, apparently, and they'll go around and they'll scoop up that blood too, right? So the more
you drink
it. I'm not sure about drinking, but I know they scoop it up. Yeah.
I mean, who's better? Whose blood would be better to drink than your own Primarch's?
Is that like cannibalism? Sort of like, it's not cannibalism, but
it's not cannibalism. It, just think of it as a water fountain.
I mean, listen, I'm just saying, if my family member was dead and still leaking soda, I would simply just not drink the soda.
Listen, the way I look at it is, you need blood. And he's just leaking it for 10,000 years. What are you going to do?
I'd
are you collecting
spout
it?
I'd put a spout at the bottom of the fucking keg.
That motherfucker like a keg. I mean, if it's leaking, what are they doing? Are they like scooping it up? And...
I could truth be told, I have no idea.
Yeah, does they're it letting like, it go to waste. I'm just saying,
it's
a party
tap. I don't know.
It's a party foul. It's I'm just saying, party foul.
Is there a drain at the bottom? Because I feel like it would fill up after a while.
This is why I don't understand, because stasis, everything is like not affected by time. It's perfect, you know, like frozen.
Yeah.
Except whenever, like, it's been, like, supposedly the blood's leaking, which means it's moving in a stasis tube.
Right.
And then when they get it out, do they, like, shut the stasis tube off and Sigmund's body just, you know, like, Family Guy death poses on the floor? Or
yeah.
Yeah. Last couple things. So I just want to wrap up so we got this. There was a few different incidents we aren't going to really cover, but just to sort of toss it in there.
Hey, there was a moment between Dante and Gilliman, too.
There wasn't. Oh, yeah, there was. Well, yeah, because they got Primaris reinforcements, because directly after the Tyranid thing, Gilliman showed up and was like, hey, hello, Dante. Here's your new brothers. Have fun. And all this stuff. And that's also whenever you appointed Dante as regent of Imperium Nihilus. So all of Imperium Nihilus falls under Dante's command
and
Gilliman's command.
And he didn't fucking want any of it. He just wants to die.
Yeah. It's like, no, Gilliman, I just want to die. Stop
Gilliman,
it.
Gilliman, just kill me, please. Best I can do is make you the fucking
promotion.
Regent.
Fuck you. Yeah.
So we're currently in M42, right?
As technically, the timeline? With some hefty grains of salt, yeah.
Okay, because Dante was born in M40.
Okay, so the timeline, let's have the discussion now, is first off, whenever, according to, there's a timeline that was pre-Gilliman, okay? And according to that, we were like M39.999. It was that year for a very long time, right? And it's supposed to be M40, hence 40K, because this was all happening as we're going into 40K, and that's the end of the universe, right? Everything was happening, yada yada. Gilliman came in and he actually redid all the calendar using his uber autism, and he's like, listen, the timeline, because we have so many planets, so many different of this, there's no way to accurately gauge how much time was came in, which means, according to Gilliman's estimates, he said, we are either between M38 or M45. That's how bad we are.
What the fuck?
Yeah. And
guys,
so he,
my autism has created a new thing. Galactic time zones.
Yeah,
this motherfucker
much.
Had cable company time. He's like, hey, we'll be there between 8 o'clock tomorrow and September.
Yeah, pretty much. But that also goes back to, you know, in a galaxy, you can't really accurately keep track of time, right? It's really, really hard to in any meaningful way. And the further along you go, the more fucked up the calendar is going to be.
I can see that.
I mean,
you
it's
have
only a 7,000-year difference.
Yeah, there's there's several different star systems, and they all have different...
So, unironically, he ends up just saying, we're just going to take a date somewhere in the middle, M41. There we go. M41, M42. So, if you want to say we're in M40, M41, or M42, all those are accurate. Yeah.
Okay. Because
can I say we're in M45?
If you want to. Yeah.
Cool.
Yeah.
When do we get to Warhammer 50K?
That's that's fan accounts, actually. There's some interesting stuff, because some people have like, let's see how it'll be 10,000 more years in the future, stuff like that. It's actually kind of interesting seeing what people guess it would be like, which is super fascinating.
I just want to fast forward to when Russ comes back.
I would say it's all the same.
Don't worry. Well,
no one has done anything to progress anything.
We'll all be in retirement homes, and then they'll finally be like, Russ, coming in 2089.
Yeah, I'll be on my deathbed when they announce Russ, and that'll be, I'll have a heart attack.
Your heart getting out from the Russ announcement. Yeah.
Yeah, because this
they
thing
finally
that,
did it.
Because if Dante was born in M40 and it is currently M42, that motherfucker's like 2,000 years old.
Yeah.
Yeah, roughly.
Yeah, roughly.
Which is fucking, I mean, granted, you see Astartes, you know, yeah, they've lived for centuries. Well, centuries is hundreds of years. This yeah. guy's lived for millennia.
Oh, yeah.
That's like someone like being alive today. Like, yeah, I knew Jesus. Like, he was like the little kid, like right down the street. Shit, he liked to play with wood. It was yeah, crazy.
You seen, wow. Bro, yeah. Whenever you put it in that context, that really fucks you up, doesn't it? Shit.
Yeah. Yeah. Have you seen the pictures of Dante without his the
death mask?
Yeah.
Or whatever?
Well, yeah, without his death mask on, like he just looks like a decrepit old fucking man. Yeah.
Well, that's what happens when you stop drinking blood for centuries.
He has not seen a dermatologist. So a couple more events of note. The Blood Angels were active in like the second and third war for Armageddon. Okay. And also they had a civil war thanks to Fabius Bile.
Oh, Fabulous Bill.
That is way too convoluted to get into. Just know they do not like Fabius Bile one fucking bit.
I can't think of many people that like Fabius
Bile. Yeah, that's what I'm saying.
Like, you're not wrong.
But... Outside of Emperor's Children, like who really cares?
I don't even think the Emperor's Children really like Fabius Bile.
No, every single person, unless you're in his like little apothecarian thing, hate Fabius Bile. Hate him. Typhus especially hates him. Obviously, what all the Imperium hates him, right? Abaddon, to a degree, fucking hates him. Even though he's trying to be like, I hate you, but also you're really fucking good at what you do.
The Drukhari so. Fucking hate him.
Oh, Drukhari fucking after what he did, yeah, holy shit.
The Eldar hate him.
Yeah.
Orcs hate everybody.
The only person who doesn't hate Fabius Bile is Treason. They actually like each other.
I could see it.
Relatively.
Yeah. You think Trajan would have already collected this motherfucker.
Well, you would think so, but instead he got a clone Fulgrim, so he was happy.
A clone Fulgrim that he made.
Yeah. Yeah. That was a one-to-one.
Maybe that's how he bought his...
Uncorrupted.
Mm-hmm.
So...
And whatever okay, so he bought his
way. He bought his way out of a Pokeball by giving this dude a fucking replica of the Primarch.
Yes. Yeah, and then they know, has a clone of Fulgrim... sitting in the gallery, and then that has so many things in his gallery that's just never been touched.
Yeah.
40K is just, GW's just like,
Yeah. We'll have to do an episode on Bile, hopefully sometime soon.
We'll have to do an episode on Treason.
Oh, that too. Yeah.
Yeah.
So the giant galactic clusterfuck of Call, Treason, and Bile. Yeah.
Especially when you throw a fucking, who's the other one? The one that hates Treason. Orkin,
yeah.
Especially when you throw Treason and Orkin, who absolutely fucking hate each other, into the mix.
Wait, is Orkin the one who thinks that he's a freaking human?
No, that's Sandrick.
Oh,
no.
Okay.
Orkin wants to be like a sin to basically being a pure light. Yeah.
Orkin, he's one of their, a chronomancer?
Yeah.
He controls time.
Oh, interesting.
The fabric of time.
Okay.
Anyway, so that's sort of... Are we missing anything?
For Blood Angels? No. One actually thing to note, and I saw that it was actually pretty cool, is about Dante. Apparently, he fucking cleaved Scarbrand in twain. He cleaved them in two.
Based.
At the gates of Pandemonium. That's fucking impressive.
Not very impressive.
Now, also, that's a big L for Scarbrand, because not only did he get punched into the abyss by Khorne himself, but... You know, so
Scarbrand only gets wins in Warhammer Fantasy. That's it. And even that's dubious.
These guys have guns.
But other than that, I think we did a pretty good job covering a lot of. I mean, there's so much Blood Angel shit out there.
There is, and again, we've said this before. Whenever we hear and we cover like Nylor's, Imperial Fist, Blood Angels, anybody else, we're here to give you a sense of the Legion, who they are, but we can't cover everything. We're not a Wikipedia page, okay?
Yeah.
So if we miss something, honestly, put it in comments. Let us know. And maybe like if we look into it, we like it, we'll do even a dedicated episode on that, or specific war zone, specific character, specific incident, you know?
Yeah. And by all means, if we got something wrong, let us know in the comments too, because we got something wrong in the Night Lords episode and somebody called us out and it's like, you know what? We appreciate that because...
Actually, you know what? I'm going to pin that comment.
There's so much information that we have to kind of sift through with a lot of these that we're bound to get something wrong or not completely correct, but...
We strive to give you the truth, but we are not Luton. We're three guys talking about the lore, and we strive to give you the best lore, but also in a very casual manner and setting, right? We're not going to fuck it up like other guys, but at the same time, we're not, you know, if there's some minor details are wrong, please correct, Yeah.
Yeah. When Luton drops a video, he's probably been working on it for like the last 2.5 weeks or so.
He's got like an academic essay on that stuff.
Yeah, yeah. We're also not going to sit here and fucking read off the lexicanum and the Wikipedia page like certain places.
And we're not going to claim memes or actual lore. No, not yet.
We don't have enough supporters to start an internet.
We're not trying to start drama. It just upsets all of us. Yeah.
Maybe at 1,000 followers, we'll start an internet beef.
Oh, there you go, boys. 1,000 subs. We got the beef. 1,000
subs. We'll
start
call
a bunch
out.
Of drama.
1,000 subs. We'll go to a random Warhammer streamer and we'll kick him in the nads live on fucking camera. Your choice in the comments.
Yeah. Yeah. At 1,000 subs, we'll call out one person. We'll just start the beef right there. Yeah. And every 1,000
subs. We'll start making fun of everything.
Community directed beef.
1,001 subscribers, Groot will make a diss rap.
If you were to make a diss rap, who would you call out first? Like, not even first. Like, who would be your main target on that
one? Oh, I feel like that would already be starting fucking drama.
I'm really curious. You can tell me afterwards.
Afterwards. We'll keep it under wraps.
Yeah.
Let's see.
At 1,001 subs, soon. You'll find out who Groot would call out.
Find out more.
We'll do that. Yeah. Because, yeah, that is true. We're already starting that shit.
I'll say this because this is a very easy and honestly like a safe pick. I'll call out the Templin Institute for their bullshit.
Meh. Okay. Yeah. Fair enough.
Talk about tourists. Anyway.
Fair enough. Yeah. Oh, God.
Yeah.
The tourism is strong with you.
I won't call him out, but it rhymes with guess mammer.
What did Baltimore do?
No, I respect Baltimore.
Yeah, I love Baltimore.
Baltimore is my fucking goddamn chapter chaplain fucking whatever his name is from the blood company.
Hopefully one day we could do like a little like we could have him on or something.
Like a collaboration with him.
Collaboration.
That would be dope.
Get him to do like a narration or something. Yeah.
Maybe throw a couple voices in there. Yeah. You can give him your really good Arab voice.
Hello and welcome to Denny's. How may I help you today?
His Scandinavian Russian Arab voice that he does.
Hey. I'm trying to be diverse at the same time.
Work on your Mongolian accent. We could do a White Scars looking thing.
Mongolian. Anyways, before we go down that path, anything
else? 500
subs. 500
subs.
500 subs, we get racist. Come on.
Jesus.
God, I was just going to say at 500 racist. Subs, we get you to do a Mongolian throat singing. But
I'm going all the way. I'm just going to start telling racist jokes. We're not censoring that shit.
Oh, man. Salamander jokes. Let's go.
Anyways, anything else?
I think that's everything.
That's all, man. I believe we covered a good bit of... Not only Sanguinius, but the Blood Angels in general.
Yeah, I agree. Okay, so. Well, in that case, if we're all ready, we'll see you in the next episode, which marks the halfway point of Iron Hands.
The Iron Hands. We finally get to start talking about the Broken Legions.
Yeah, woo!
10th Legion, Iron Hands.
Surprisingly, you'll never guess how they got their name.
Yeah, led by the Iron Hands himself.
Whose name is Iron Hand?
Yeah. Whose name is a Latin form of Iron Hands.
So until next time, guys, don't forget to like, follow, subscribe, comment for engagement, follow the Discord.
We love you all.
Fuck it, we bow.
Fuck it, we bow.